Thank you. Thank you. Good evening. Good evening and welcome to the Mike Lazaridis Theater of Ideas here at Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada. And welcome to this Perimeter's public lecture series. My name is Greg Dick. I'm the Director of Educational Outreach here at Perimeter, and it is a pleasure to welcome everyone here this evening, both those of you here in the live studio audience and those of you watching online, whether on Perimeter's website or on one of our many science communication colleagues' websites around the globe. The lecture itself will last approximately 1 hour and will be followed by a question and answer session. For those of you watching online, Dr. Stephanie Keating and a team of researchers are behind their keyboards at the ready, monitoring the Facebook and Twitter feeds, ready to engage in conversation throughout the lecture. If you want to participate in that conversation, please use hashtag PILive. And I will take a question or two also from the online audience. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce an eminent scientist and the director of Perimeter Institute, Dr. Neil Turok, to introduce tonight's very special guest speaker. Neil?
Thank you. A real treat lies ahead of us this evening. Let me begin with a very warm welcome to you all. We at Perimeter are fortunate indeed to have such incredible supporters. In particular, I'd like to mention Mike Lazaridis, Perimeter's founder and first supporter, as well as Bill Down, CEO of BMO Financial Group, which supported our first named chair, the Isaac Newton Chair at Perimeter Institute. Well, great scientists have to be great detectives, going after clues which allow them to solve important puzzles. But very often, they also need to be entrepreneurs, team builders, and leaders. And tonight's speaker is no exception. Born on Cape Breton Island in Nova Scotia, Art McDonald obtained his bachelor's and master's degrees from Dalhousie before moving to Caltech for his PhD. In 1970, he returned to Canada's Chalk River Nuclear Laboratory as a research officer before taking up a professorship at Princeton in 1982. Well, in 1989, he came back to Canada to a professorship at Queen's and to lead the development of the Solar Neutrino Observatory, or SNOW, an incredibly ambitious experiment 2 kilometers underground in a nickel mine in Sudbury. The goal of SNOW was to solve a puzzle about neutrinos from the sun. Neutrinos are some of the strangest particles we know. They carry no electric charge and they don't feel light. They are literally a dark corner in the Standard Model, but one, as it turns out, in which treasure was hidden. In the Standard Model, particles come in 3 types or flavors, and we don't know why. There are electrons, muons, and tauons, and correspondingly, electron, mu, and tau neutrinos. According to the original Standard Model, developed in the early 1970s, the 3 types of neutrino never intermingle. But in the late 1970s, theorists realized that you could add an extra term to the model, giving a small mass to the neutrinos and allowing them to mix. The extra term encodes physics at extremely high energies, way beyond the reach of experiments like the Large Hadron Collider, energies only accessed in the Big Bang. However, its effects can still be seen today because it causes an electron neutrino emitted from the sun to slowly change into a mu or a tau neutrino on its way to the Earth. This transformation might explain why experiments had so far detected too few electron neutrinos coming from the sun, compared to theoretical predictions without the extra term. The nuclear reactions which power the sun send hundreds of billions of neutrinos through every square centimeter of the Earth every second. The vast majority of them just pass straight through. The best way to detect them is to use heavy water, an expensive isotope used in nuclear reactors. In the early 1980s, Art and his colleagues persuaded the Canadian Nuclear Agency to loan them 1,000 tons of heavy water, worth well over $300 million, for a unique experiment which could detect all type of neutrinos coming from the sun, all types of neutrinos coming from the sun. And the rest is history. They resolved the solar neutrino puzzle by showing that indeed neutrinos mix on their way from the sun to the Earth. The extra term in the Standard Model, which they discovered, is now one of the most important clues we possess about physics at extremely high energies. It may even help to explain the abundance of matter and why there is so little antimatter in the universe today. Well, soon after I moved to Perimeter in 2008, Art invited me to visit him at Queen's, and I vividly remember a conversation we had on a hill overlooking Kingston about the future of physics. Art is not only a visionary, he's a great human being. He's a pathbreaker, completely devoted to encouraging and helping others to share in the joy of discovery and to better appreciate our world. It is with immense pleasure that I introduce the 2015 Physics Nobel Laureate and Perimeter Institute Governing Board Member, Art McDonald.
Thank you. Thank you, Neil. As Neil mentioned, I'm a member of the Board of Directors here at Perimeter, and I really believe in Perimeter. This is a fantastic place. It would be a fantastic place anywhere in the world, but the fact that it's here in Canada, thanks to Mike and the other supporters, is really fantastic for our country. We really are leaders in this area, in all of the areas that Perimeter is working in. And we're very pleased also at Snow Lab, our underground observatory near Sudbury, to be partnered with Perimeter in a number of ways. And in some sense, the experiments we do for some of the Perimeter program are the experimental arm of the theory that they are doing, and vice versa. And that's of great value to us to have such a resource as Perimeter here in the country and opportunities to interact with the very high quality scientists that there are here in Perimeter. So it's really a pleasure for me to be here and speak this evening. And so what I'm going to speak about is, as it says, a deeper understanding of our universe from 2 kilometers underground. We have a laboratory which started with the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory, which you see here. Back in 1984, we started developing this project. And we started constructing it in 1990. By 1999, we were taking data. This is the Sudbury Neutrino Observatory area here. It's all 2 kilometers underground. And we have since, starting in 2003, been able to expand the underground excavated volume by a factor of 3 or so. And we are now hosting 4 or 5 other experiments that are still on the cutting edge of measurements of the type that Neil was talking about, that I'll describe in a little bit more detail. We're trying to understand further properties of neutrinos in a reincarnation of the Snow Project, and we're attempting to understand the particles that make up the dark matter, which is about 5 times as much mass as we are in this universe, and I'll talk a little bit about that as well. So we're fortunate to have this opportunity to really have the lowest radioactivity location in the world to do these experiments. And as a result of having this unique experimental situation, which often is the case, if you can really push your technology to new lengths, then you can do cutting-edge science that otherwise would be impossible. By being 2 kilometers underground, we're able to shield out the cosmic rays that otherwise would essentially make our detectors glow like the northern lights. Those cosmic particles that create the northern lights would produce the same sort of glow in our detectors, but by going 2 kilometers underground, we have shielded that out by a factor of about 1 million, and therefore we can look for very rare processes that otherwise would be impossible. It enables us to study everything from the most microscopic particles, and neutrinos certainly qualify as that,
go all the way to the farthest reaches of the universe as well. We're understanding processes, as Neil was mentioning, that relate to the Big Bang and time shortly thereafter. In between, we have been studying the sun in great detail. Our next experiment, Snow Plus, in the same location, will study neutrinos from the Earth and understand the heat flow generated by uranium and thorium, which appears to be about 40% of the heat flow from the Earth. We have applications to dark matter, and dark matter is what holds our Milky Way galaxy together. Otherwise, if we just had the glowing matter, it would basically fly apart. And so, by having this unique environment, we really can do a lot of things. And so, questions that we can study are things like, how do stars like our sun burn? And in such stars, the elements from which we are created, many of them are made. A few of them are created in the original Big Bang. All the ones up to iron are created in stars like our sun, or stars not so different from our sun. The elements heavier than iron are created in supernova, in the collapse of stars after they've finished their burning process. And so really us, what we're made from, is really important in these measurements. We understand more about the basic laws of physics for very fundamental particles by these measurements, and we understand more about the composition of our universe and things such as dark matter that are at this point unidentified in terms of their details. How do you make these measurements? Well, you make them in some cases by measuring neutrinos, and I'll tell you more about neutrinos. They're not exactly common parlance in everyday life, and we'll talk a little bit more about them. In our case, they're the ones that came from the core of the sun, where the power is being generated. We also are studying dark matter particles, which are studied in somewhat similar techniques, but a little different specifically for them. And then finally, we have such a low radioactive background, we can look for forms of radioactivity that are extremely rare, situations where the half-life for this radioactivity is greater than 10 to the 26 years. In other words, you collect something in excess of 10 to the 26 atoms, and you look for a few years to try to see if you can see a decay that is of that nature. And so it really is unusual things you can do once you create this environment. So let's start with the sun. The sun is burning by nuclear fusion. In the center, it is so hot, it has collapsed down to a point where the center of the sun is so hot, it is enabling the nuclei to overcome Coulomb repulsion between the atoms and the nuclei inside the atoms, and these nuclei can fuse together. And nuclear fusion, in the case of the ones powering the sun, are giving off lots of energy, and they're also giving off copious numbers of neutrinos. And these particles called neutrinos are unusual particles. Along with electrons and quarks, they're the basic particles that we don't know how to subdivide any further. They come in three flavors, as was mentioned by Neil: electron, mu, and tau neutrinos. They're described by the standard model of elementary particles. They only stop if they hit the nucleus of an atom or the electron going around it head on. And that's because they only feel the weak force, which is a very short range force. So for them, matter is essentially open space. And so they can pass through the distance that light travels in a year of lead with only a 50% chance of encountering something. Very substantial penetrations by these particles, which is great because you can get them from the core of the sun with relatively little impedance in getting to us here on Earth. But on the other hand, it makes them very difficult to detect. And so we had to build a detector the size of a 10-story building and use the most favorable material, heavy water, in order to do this measurement that I'm going to describe to you. The standard model, as Neil said in its initial form, said that they shouldn't change from one type of neutrino to another. The electron neutrinos produced in the core of the sun shouldn't change into the other types before reaching us here. If they do make such a change, it implies that they have a mass which is greater than zero. They're not traveling at the speed of light and have zero rest mass as photons do. And we've been able to show clearly that they do change their flavor, and that has added a piece to the standard model that, as Neil said, has implications at the highest energy, highest energies that one can have in the universe. So just to have a look at where neutrinos fit in, because you're not normally hearing about them when you talk about chemistry or physics. The elementary particles as we understand them these days are a set of quarks, three flavors of quarks, a set of electron, mu, and tau. These are particles that are called leptons. They're mus and taus are similar to electrons. They're charged particles, but these are heavier. And a neutrino associated with each of these three leptons. And then there are the force carriers that you see here, and the Higgs boson that you heard so much about that completed the standard model, and finally the graviton, which of course is a part of gravity, and now gravitational waves, which has been an absolutely remarkable discovery in the last couple of months, and really is going to revolutionize our ability to do astronomy. Protons and neutrons are made from three quarks of the up and down nature. They are inside the nucleus of an atom, and the electrons surround that nucleus, and that gives you the atom that you're familiar with. Neutrinos that only feel the weak force, as I mentioned, are produced when one type of quark changes into another. And so that happens in certain forms of radioactivity, particularly beta decay. In fact, if you eat a banana, you're getting a fair number of neutrinos compared to any other material because of the potassium in the banana. So think about that the next time you have it. They also are produced very, very extensively in the nuclear reactions that power the sun. And as was mentioned before, the standard model does not have neutrinos with a finite mass, at least in its initial incarnation. So why should you care? Why are we that interested in neutrinos in the sun and the information we can get from these sorts of measurements I'm going to tell you about? Well, I've already told you that, in fact, the elements that were made of, a number of them were produced in the nuclear processes in the center of the sun. Hydrogen actually is left over from the original Big Bang, but carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, a large part of our bodies, are made in the sun, or stars like it. Then there also are the heavier elements that are produced in supernova. Well, these days it is thought from models of how stars collapse and how they produce elements, it's thought that neutrinos are absolutely essential in order to keep that process of a collapsing star going forward. And so they fit, they are very important, therefore, in those processes in nature. We're studying nuclear fusion in the sun, where the fusion is held in place by gravity. When we study these neutrinos coming from the core of the sun, what we're observing is the fusion process held in place by gravity. There's a very major effort here on Earth to try to produce fusion energy. The International Tokamak Project in France is attempting to do the same thing, to basically harness to have the sun burn, if you like, in the middle of this tokamak device, where magnetic fields are being used to try to keep the very hot plasma in the middle from scraping atoms off of the surroundings. Every time a particle tries to get out, they push it back in with a magnetic field. It has not been successful so far, but they've gone in terms of producing full amount of energy, but they have gone to the break-even point with this process. If in fact that can be successful, then the deuterium in the water on Earth would be a very substantial source of energy for the nuclear fusion process. What we've shown by our measurements that show that we understand the way in which nuclear fusion happens in the core of the sun to within better than 10% in terms of the numbers of neutrinos we measure, gives us strong confidence that the physics and plasma physics associated with nuclear fusion is very well understood. And so it really is the confinement you need to focus on when it comes to harnessing that for human benefit. And it's a good example of the situation where if you study basic science, and understand the basic physics very well, there will be a much better opportunity to harness it for the benefit of mankind. Neutrinos, it turns out, are produced very extensively in the Big Bang. There are more neutrinos than anything other than photons produced in the original Big Bang, and they have a significant influence on how the universe evolves. They are a significant influence in the formation of large-scale structure, formation, stars, galaxies, and so on. And in fact, in the models of how the universe has evolved, which are remarkably accurate these days, the mass of the neutrino is an important parameter. And then finally, there are detectors, most notably one in which they have instrumented 1 cubic kilometer of ice under the South Pole, that are looking at very high energy neutrinos with directionality. And so really we are in the realm of doing neutrino astronomy, looking for those very energetic sources that can produce the highest energy neutrinos, higher energies actually than anything we've been able to produce in accelerators here on Earth. And so neutrinos are pretty ubiquitous particles in the world of physics. They're just not in the human realm of things. About once in your lifetime, a neutrino will hit one atom in your body and turn it into something else. And only if you happen to be, if it happens to be your eye that this neutrino hits, and if your eye happens to be closed, as maybe some of them are at the back of this room by the time I get to this point in the lecture, will you observe anything? You will be completely oblivious to the fact that that has taken place. So neutrinos are outside our normal experience, but very substantial in terms of influencing how our universe has evolved. What we set out to answer was a puzzle that had developed from some pioneering measurements by Ray Davis, who received actually the Nobel Prize for his pioneering of this field, where he had made measurements of the type of neutrinos that are produced in the core of the Sun, and found that he was only seeing about 1/3 the number compared to the calculations of them. And so we were faced with a situation back in 1984, when 16 of us came together to consider starting this experiment, that either the calculations were wrong, or his experiment could have been wrong, or that actually this process where electron neutrinos can change into another type, which would have been outside the accepted standard model at that point, one or the other, either the experiment or the calculations were wrong, or we had something really substantial in terms of an understanding at a very basic level. And so we set about in 1984 to do this measurement. There's a fellow by the name of Herb Chen, who was a professor at University of California at Irvine, who called someone in Canada, Cliff Hargrove in Ottawa, and said, "Do you think there's any possibility we could borrow 5,000 or 4,000, he said, tons of heavy water?" Well, at that point he was asking if we could borrow $1.2 billion worth of heavy water. And we worked it around a bit and got it down to 300 million, but even that, it was quite remarkable that in fact we could borrow that Atomic Energy of Canada was willing to loan it to us if we took really good care of it, and we did. At the same time, there was a fellow named George Ewan, who was a professor at Queen's, who had been investigating the possibility of producing this very low radioactivity underground environment, and he had come up with the Creighton Mine near Sudbury as the most ideal place to do this. And sure enough, there was a vice president of INCO, their research branch, that was willing to allow us to coexist with their mining operations. We still coexist with their mining operations. Thousands of tons of ore a day coming out of that very productive mine, along with our activities. And so in 1984, we came together. This shows essentially the original 16 at a collaboration meeting a couple of years later. The spokespersons in the first case were Herb Chen, who was the US spokesperson, and George Ewan, who was the Canadian spokesperson, joined a little later in 85 by Dave Sinclair as the UK spokesperson. Unfortunately, within 6 months of this photo, Herb Chen passed away from leukemia. He wasn't feeling well at that meeting, and you can see a very young man and someone that we really respected, and that set us back. But we proceeded. I ended up taking over as the U.S. Spokesman. I was at Princeton at the time. And then in 1989, I came back to Canada to take over as the overall director of the project because George Ewan was about to retire at that point. And so we started with 16, and as you'll see later on, we ended up with 273 authors on our physics papers. And what I like to think of is the fact that the difference between the 16 and the 273 is predominantly students and postdocs. And in many cases, people that have gone on to faculty positions and other very responsible positions in science as a result of participating in this project. So let's talk a little bit about the SNOW project. We have the neutrinos streaming out from the sun. We have this detector, which is 2 kilometers underground. And about once an hour, you get a little burst of light from the neutrino striking the heavy water. Now, heavy water is rather unique. It's H2O, but with an extra neutron in each of the H's. And so it's really deuterium oxide. And it is that deuterium that provides the unique target for the neutrinos, the electron neutrinos from the sun, in terms of understanding whether or not they are changing from one type to the other. Particularly because there's one reaction where any neutrino, any of the three, if there has been a change from electron neutrinos to the other types, any of them striking deuterium and producing a free neutron in the heavy water, they would do it with equal sensitivity. In addition to that, there's a reaction in which specifically only the electron neutrinos striking the neutron inside the deuterium will produce a fast-moving electron that makes a cone of light, and we can distinguish between those two reactions, and we can compare how many of them there are. And so if the number that you observe of electron neutrinos is the same as the total number, then nothing has happened. There's been no change of flavor. However, that's not what we observed. We observed that about two-thirds of the electron neutrinos had changed into the other types before they reached our detectors, simply by looking at those two reactions. You have to be very careful because this reaction can also be produced by local radioactivity. And so we had to have, as I said, the lowest radioactivity location that had ever been produced, and that meant not only going 2 kilometers underground, but also having an extremely low radioactivity location in order to do the experiment. And I'll show you that a bit in a moment. Light is produced by the neutron capturing in other materials in several of the phases of the project, and that basically produces a burst of light. The third phase of the project, we actually put in some neutron detectors to observe them separately. Three phases which all agreed. So imagine you're a neutrino. Here's a hydrogen, these are hydrogen, now deuterium in D2O. The first type of burst of light that's going to be created is equally produced by all neutrino types. And it's that, and that burst of light is different from the second one that is produced only by electron neutrinos. And so comparing those two, where the heavy water is essential to the process, is what we did in the experiment. Notice that heavy water is actually not radioactive material. It's very naturally occurring, about 1 in 6,400 of the molecules that you drink of water are in fact heavier, and that's basically the only difference in their chemical structure. There's a little bit of difference, but essentially they're the same. When we were trying to convince the people in Sudbury that this was a benign thing that we were doing in their mind, one of the professors from Queens went to the city council meeting and drank a glass of heavy water just to show them that it was perfectly okay. He actually poured in a little bit of teachers and said nothing improves the flavor of heavy water but teachers does. But anyway, we were able to convince them, and we had tremendous support in the Sudbury area for this. And you can see that there's so much deuterium that if nuclear fusion can be harnessed, it'll be a very valuable source of energy. So what did we build? Well, this person here is to scale. This is 2 kilometers underground. It's about 10 stories high, 34 meters high. And in the center is the biggest Christmas ornament you've ever seen. It's 12 meters in diameter and 5 centimeters, 2 inches thick. And it had to be built out of 120 separate pieces, which were small enough to come down in the mine elevator. It was all done in ultra-clean conditions. Class 2000 is what we managed throughout the construction of the experiment, such that the dust on all of the 1 million pieces was less than you could pile on your thumbnail, less than a gram of dust on the entire detector. That was very important because of this reaction that could be caused by radioactivity that would mimic the main reaction we were looking for. In the middle is 1,000 tons of heavy water in this transparent plexiglass or acrylic sphere on loan for a dollar. We actually had to pay about $1 million a year for insurance for it, but that's that was necessary. 9,500 light sensors capable of observing a single photon with a probability of about 20%, something like that. Someone calculated it's the equivalent of observing a candle on the moon. And so it really was a sensitive detector for anything that happened, in particular a neutrino coming in and producing a burst of light. Everything was bathed in ultra-pure light water, a billion times more pure than tap water, and that was contained within a plastic-lined chamber, which as you can see is 34 meters high and about 22 meters in diameter. And that liner also suppressed radon gas from the surrounding rock. So here you can see where we are in the mine. You come down in the number 9 shaft, about 3 minutes to go down 2 kilometers. So it's a fast but very smooth ride down. And then we're about 1.5 kilometers out in this area. This is the ore, which is actually produced by a fracture zone produced by a meteorite that landed in this direction that really created all of the very rich mining areas in the vicinity of Sudbury. And so we are away down and away out. There's the CN Tower. That's the Canadian icon that I use in my talks here in Canada. In the US, I use the entire state building. And you may think I made a mistake, but I have it on good authority from my 7-year-old son. When we were at Princeton, he took a trip to New York City, and he came back and told us he had seen the entire state building. So it's a little smaller than this one. There's about I think 5 CN towers and maybe 6 entire state buildings. So anyway, you can see how deep we are. You can see the process of building this, which took us about 4 years to do overall, after the excavation was completed. The acrylic sphere had to be bonded together from 120 pieces, very carefully set up on jigs and bonded carefully. The light sensors, you can see here, they're actually covered with dust covers until we finished doing the acrylic sphere, and then dust covers were able to be pulled off. And you're seeing, looking in at the center sphere where the heavy water was. And then finally, after all the cables are in place, taking the signals back to our control room, this is what it finally looked like. Very extensive water purification equipment, as you can see. And you can see from this how clean the floors are there. I was quite pleased when my mother came to visit. She actually came underground. I think she was amazed that I could be responsible for anything that looked like that. She said, "Looks pretty clean, dear," so I figured that was an ultimate compliment. You can see when Stephen Hawking visited that we were, some challenges. We used a vacuum before he came down, brought him down in a special rail car that Inco had created for him. And an absolutely fascinating individual, as Neil and others here at Perimeter know. The spirit that he has is to go with his intellect is absolutely amazing and inspiring. And he was formulating questions for our grad students underground. And this was in 1998. I'll show you later that he came back again in 2012, which we were very pleased about. So if I go to the next slide, everything didn't go perfectly. You can see, I mentioned this array of neutron detectors that we put in at the end in the heavy water. We flew them in with a little submarine, and you can see the submarine right here, actually, bringing one of them down to hook onto something that we had, little hooks that we'd put on the inside of the acrylic sphere. They were a great success, but what we started with, of course, was not what you see there, but rather, well, if you had a choice of picking the color for your submarine, right? What would you pick? So, of course, we picked the yellow submarine. The problem was that yellow paint was far too radioactive. And so what you see is this very prosaic green paint, which it turns out that anybody over about 23 was totally incapable of flying that, operating that remote submarine. And there were a number of us older folks that tried it, and we just were totally incompetent. It was the practice with the video games and also just the general ability at that age that made a difference. Next slide shows our results, and it shows it in the way of comparing what we measured in terms of the number of neutrinos from one particular reaction that powers the sun. And you can see it's in terms of millions per square centimeter per second, and we're seeing about 5 million per square centimeter per thumbnail, if you like, per second from this reaction. This is the calculation that was in dispute, and this is the measurement we made with all neutrino types, and it matched very accurately. In fact, our uncertainties now are smaller than the uncertainties in the calculations, and we're actually testing two different approaches to the solar models these days with the measurements we've made. The electron neutrinos are only about a third of the total, and that is true with less than one chance in 10 million that they are not oscillating. And so we had a very clear, as we say in the field, 5 standard deviation measurement of the fact that these oscillations were taking place, and a very clear indication then that flavor is changing and that neutrinos have a finite mass. And that's basically what the Nobel Prize was awarded for, was a very clear measurement. We went on in the other phases to increase our accuracy, which helps us in terms of understanding various parameters of the neutrinos. We can determine differences in mass and interaction strengths and so on from that. The theory that these days is used to explain what's happening here, it's a totally quantum mechanical phenomenon. And what one says is that there isn't a one-to-one correspondence between the mass eigenstate, as they say in quantum mechanics, and the original state in which the either electron, muon, or tau neutrino was produced. And you know what you're producing because there's an electron, mu, or tau associated with the production. But it's thought that an electron neutrino has approximately this much mass 1, this much mass 2, and a very small amount of mass 3, and equivalently different numbers for the other neutrino types. As neutrinos travel, it is the mass states that determine the way in which these components change, and they do change as they travel. And so later on, when you make a measurement after they've traveled some distance, you find that the electron neutrino does, if you make a measurement and ask how many electron neutrinos are there, since the eigenstate no longer looks like of the thing you're measuring no longer looks explicitly like an electron neutrino, like that color scheme there, you find that only one third of the time does it show up as a electron neutrino. This is the way in which quantum mechanics works. You, as we say, project out the probability of observing an electron neutrino, and it turns out to be about 33%. And the others are what makes up the other 66%. And so that's the quantum mechanics behind what we think is happening. If this is happening, then you think that the neutrinos have a finite mass. And the reason is that for this process of oscillation, as we describe it, to take place, you cannot have the neutrinos traveling at the speed of light, or else you don't have, if you like, a clock in their frame moving along with them that's capable of registering this process of oscillation. Therefore, they must be traveling less than the speed of light and must have a finite mass. And so that's the physics that goes behind it. So, now, some of you might want... Well, actually, I've been trying to explain this a lot since last October the 6th. And sometimes I'm successful and sometimes I'm not successful. And I think this little clip is...
winner of a Nobel Prize, here to explain why he's the best in the world at what he does, is Art McDonald.
Hi, I'm Art McDonald. I'm a professor emeritus at Queen's University, originally from Cape Breton, and I attended Dalhousie University. And I'm a co-winner of the 2015 Nobel Prize in Physics. People from 22 Minutes have asked me to come in and explain what I and our team did to win this prize. We demonstrated that the flavor of neutrinos produced in the core of the sun, electron neutrinos, changed into one of the other two flavors, muon and tau neutrinos, as they traveled from the core of the sun to... I'm being told I have to make it simpler. Neutrinos are very basic subatomic particles that we don't know how to subdivide any further. And, okay, they're asking me to dumb it down a little bit. A subatomic particle is smaller than an atom. Atom is a unit of matter. Really? You don't know what matter is? Well, it's seven. Okay, neutrinos are like Timbits. Sometimes they're like chocolate, sometimes they're like cherry-filled, and sometimes they're like the old-fashioned glaze. I must be the first person that ever won a Nobel Prize in Timbits.
So I hope that was a little clearer. This is the group of supporting agencies and the group of institutions from which our collaborators came. And this is the list that you can't read, but that I want to make sure I put up there, of the 262 living and 11 people who've passed away who made really substantial contributions to our project and were authors on our papers for the project, because really, yeah, whoever was starting a clap, I think that's what's appropriate. Because this really was a major team effort and a real international collaboration as well from day one. And I'm very proud to have been associated with this extremely competent group of people. And so, and that's why I'm standing in front of you today, is because of them. So that's what I wanted to tell you about the SNOW project. Let me now switch a little bit and tell you about where we're going in the future with SNOW Lab, where we're fortunate to be able to have about a total of three times the space that we had in the original SNOW project. You can see that at the same level, 2 kilometers down, we've created this new area. David Sinclair, from one of my closest colleagues on SNOW, from Carleton University, was the director of this project, and Nigel Smith is now the director of SNOW Lab, and David created it and Nigel is carrying it on. There are new areas where we have new experiments. Let me first tell you that we are doing the ultimate in recycling. We're reusing a $70 million experiment to do, again, cutting-edge measurements with respect to the properties of neutrinos. And for that, we need a topic that is no stranger to this place, and that is the Big Bang Theory, where one has a situation where About 13 and a half billion years ago, there was an enormous explosion, producing, we think, from matter, equal amounts of matter and antimatter, at a very fundamental level. As far as we know right now, the basic particles are electrons, quarks, and neutrinos, and different flavors of them were produced back then. And they, as the universe cooled off, interacted with each other to form neutrons and protons, and eventually then the nuclei of atoms, and then they picked up electrons, and you form neutral atoms, and then later on you start to get the structure formation as proto-galaxies and eventually these days our galaxies are produced. And so there are puzzles. Neil actually mentioned one earlier on, which is, where did all the antimatter go? I mean, you know that positrons are antimatter, and in positron emission tomography you have a situation where a positron finds a electron in somebody's body and shoots out two gamma rays in opposite directions. And if you're studying for a tumor in someone's head, you can put gamma ray detectors around the head, connect the lines for these opposite going gamma rays, and determine where they were coming from, and do a very good diagnosis of people's situation with respect to blood flow in the brain. But you don't observe positrons hanging around in equal numbers to electrons in this universe, or we'd have a real mess with gamma rays going everywhere. You do get positrons emitted by certain forms of radioactivity, and that's what gets injected for positron emission tomography. But in general, there's relatively little antimatter found in this universe, and so somehow it all decayed away. These days it is thought that perhaps the most likely candidate for that occurring relates to the properties that Neil mentioned of very high mass neutrinos, asymmetric processes that happen back in the early universe that are carried through to what we observe today. There's a process which is a very rare radioactivity called neutrinoless double beta decay that it is possible to observe, which can only happen if a neutrino is its own antiparticle. And that process, if observed, would be a very big stepping stone to understanding the theory of neutrinos being related to what was happening back in the early universe. At the same time, if you can observe that process, then you have a way of measuring the absolute mass of neutrinos. We know the differences in mass between those three states I mentioned, but we don't know the absolute mass that they're based on. And so you can, by studying this very rare radioactivity, make a measurement of those two things, and in fact that's primarily what we're trying to do with SNOW+. We have given back the heavy water, and we are now replacing it with a so-called organic scintillator, linear alkyl benzene, that is capable of having the most favorable of the nuclei that can undergo this this neutrinoless process, double beta decay, and tellurium, we will be able to dissolve in the first stage about 4 tons of this material in our detector and look at these decays, because we think we can get in the relevant region of interest, we think we can get the backgrounds down to a few per year at the most, and look for this very rare radioactivity by doing that. And so SNOW+ will be among the most sensitive of the international experiments doing this, and so we've been able to convert this experiment for a very small fraction of the total original cost to something that is still leading the world in terms of its sensitivity. We also will measure with the same material, we'll measure neutrinos from the Earth, and eventually, after we finish our measurements of double beta decay, we'll be able to study neutrinos from the sun and at any time neutrinos from supernova. Problem is that this stuff that goes in the middle, which is surrounded by regular water, is lighter than regular water, and so it's buoyant rather than being held down. And so we had to go in and do an enormous macrame job of holding down the vessel. And we're right now at the point where we have done that, which you can see here, the ropes, if you look from the inside. And we are about halfway up. Excuse me, I've gone the wrong way here. Well, I'm really going the wrong way. We have now a situation where we're filling the detector with water, and we're about halfway up. So the next topic I want to mention that we're approaching with the Snow Lab is dark matter. And we think, in the overall understanding of the composition of the universe, that we are only about 4% of the total energy in the type of matter that represents us. We think that there is another form of matter, which is really what is dark, what's in between those glowing stars when you look out on a starry night. And this dark matter, we think, is produced, is composed of particles that are more massive than anything that's ever been produced in an accelerator here on Earth. They're weakly interacting, and they're very massive, and so they're referred to as WIMPs, weakly interacting massive particles. So you've got a bunch of geeks studying WIMPs, so you've really got the ultimate in science here going on at Snow Lab. The remainder of the energy balance can be expressed as dark energy. It's something that was observed by observing that, in fact, the force of gravity is not totally attractive. There's a small repulsive component that Einstein had actually proposed for another reason, and once again was right, as it turns out, even though he himself didn't think he was at the time. But it can be expressed in a different way as dark energy, and it makes up about 70% of the universe. This essentially completes the total energy balance of the universe, and it's such that we expect the universe will expand for a very long period of time from now. We, by going underground and having a very low background, are capable of trying to make measurements of these dark matter particles, interacting with our detectors the same way that neutrinos did in the previous experiment. The sort of evidence that you see for the existence of this dark matter is if you simply plot in a spiral galaxy like this the velocity of the particles, then you find that the velocities in the outer regions are so high that if there wasn't about five times as much mass holding them in, these outer particles would fly off further into space. And we don't know what they are, but we are capable of putting forward experiments that will make measurements of what their interaction strength would be if we were to observe them, and what their mass would be if we were to observe them. And that's what we're trying to do from what we know is in our galaxy holding it together. At the same time, experiments such as ATLAS, which has a very big Canadian component in it at CERN, and theorists here who are working on similar questions are attempting to produce them for the first time since the Big Bang, because maybe the Large Hadron Collider has enough energy to do that. At Snow Lab, we have a number of experiments that are using different techniques to look for dark matter. I'll talk about one that has liquid argon in it, one that looks for the dark matter to produce a little bubble in a compressed fluid, and one that uses solid-state detectors at very low temperatures to make measurements of such things. In addition to that, we have the ability to observe a supernova in two experiments, the so-called HALO experiment using those neutron detectors I mentioned from SNOW have been recycled as well. And SNOW Plus itself will be capable of observing a supernova that could take place in our galaxy, because all of a sudden you have about a million times more neutrinos striking your detector than normal. And so it's quite clear that something is happening. In SNOW Lab, we have a number of experiments. I've highlighted in red the ones that are related to dark matter, and they are in various locations. This is the cube hall. I'll show you a picture of that. We have another space here, which is called the cryopit, which is going to be a site for a future experiment. We're waiting to see exactly which one it would be. My mother would be even more pleased about Snow Lab. This shows you the scale of that cube hall. It's truly a large location. And this shows Stephen when he visited in 2012, overlooking the cryo pit with a lot of fans. And even more inspiring as an individual, given the way in which his disease has progressed, but still the spirit is there. Amazing individual. So let me talk about a couple of these. The first experiment I'll mention is one that I'm actually involved in myself, where we're using the properties of liquid argon to try to discriminate against radioactivity that isn't due to WIMPs and get rid of it in comparison to what a WIMP does when it hits an argon nucleus and essentially makes the argon nucleus recoil. If that happens, if the argon nucleus recoils, you get a burst of light that's about 10 nanoseconds long. If you have an ionization from local radioactivity, it's about 10 microseconds long, 1,000 times in the difference, and you can do a lot of discrimination using that. We're hoping to have no radioactive background events in 3 years of running with this vat of liquid argon. Viewed, it doesn't look so different from snow, it's just smaller. The diameter here of the liquid argon in the middle is about 1.8 meters instead of the 12 meters that we had for the heavy water. There's 255 light sensors looking in at it, and this is what it looked like before the cables were put on. It's now housed in its steel shell. That's housed in an outer water bath, and we are in the process of cooling it down. Now, I mentioned to you that the way in which we are able to make measurements here is to measure the strength of a WIMP interacting with a nucleon or in one of the nuclei, in this case, argon. And what you see in green is the limitations that have been placed so far. The most recent in this region up here, which is around 100 GeV or so, which is a similar region to what the Large Hadron Collider is doing to look for these things. We have the limitation of the Lux experiment, and what we expect to do with the Deep 3600 experiment with about 4 tons of argon is to have a limit that goes down about a factor 10 from that. So we're really hopeful that that's where dark matter particles actually live. And in fact, what you see in terms of this general pink region here and a couple of specific points is where a theory known as supersymmetry might predict that they would exist, including supersymmetry theories that have been tuned to deal with what has already been observed at the Large Hadron, or not observed at the Large Hadron Collider. There's a limit as to how far you can go. Eventually, ironically, it's the neutrinos that produce a limit for detecting dark matter. And they eventually end up scattering the nuclei themselves. This is where the solar neutrinos set a limit, and this is where neutrinos from neutrinos produced in the atmosphere set a limit. Our co-winners of the Nobel Prize actually observed similar oscillations to what we did, but from neutrinos that are produced by the cosmic rays in the atmosphere. And that now comes back to bite us as a potential background. But we're hopeful that there will be experiments, including ones at Snow Lab, that go all the way down as far as you can, because finding these dark matter particles would be really quite interesting. There are some possible observations here, but they're in conflict with limits set by other experiments. People are attempting to study this region in here, and I'll show you a couple of other experiments that are attempting to do that. First of all, an experiment with a new Gilles Gerbier, new faculty member at Queen's, where they're using basically a very low threshold in terms of energy, a sphere filled with helium or neon or CH4, and their sensitivity will enable them to set limits potentially down in this region where this is that background I referred to. Then there's a major experiment from the U.S., Super CDMS, that has been in smaller scale in operation for a number of years, and it specifically targeted Snow Lab as where it would like to go, and it's one of the two major experiments that have been approved. in the US, and they will be coming in 2017. It is pieces of germanium and pieces of silicon operated at close to absolute zero as bolometers, and also the charge that's produced is tested. And by doing that, they can also specifically discriminate against things that are not nuclear recoils. And just to show you the sensitivity they're attempting to obtain, it's these lines here, that one, and these ones here. And you can see they're going to cover the majority of the region in the place where you're limited by solar neutrino backgrounds. They won't go as far down, and so some of the future experiments here will be designed more to do that. And then finally, there's an experiment that is quite unusual. It turns out that if you compress a fluid and then allow it to become a superfluid by reducing the compression, the bubbles that are formed can be seeded by nuclear recoil from a WIMP. And so they have, in the PICO experiment and the PICO 60 experiments they've done, which is now about to be turned on, they have been doing this, and they have a sensitivity to a different interaction. It's called spin-dependent, rather than the sensitivity I was showing you before for WIMPs interacting with nuclei. And they will, with their PICO 60 and a few years of operation, will be among the greatest sensitivity for that particular interaction. And this is where those supersymmetric predictions are for that. And so they're getting down into the region where the sensitivity is should be very good. So in summary, using this lowest radioactivity environment that we created, we've been able to determine clearly that neutrinos from the sun change their flavor, and that shows that they have a finite mass. SNOLAB, going forward, has a real array of experiments that are looking for WIMPs by looking at nuclear recoils, a direct detection. They're using a variety of techniques to eliminate the background and various sensitivities. And the upcoming generation of experiments will push our sensitivity for dark matter about a factor of 10 beyond where we are right now, at least. And so it's exciting to still be involved in this sort of thing here in Canada, educating lots of students. We're very pleased to have a partnership with Perimeter, where the summer students come to visit SNOLAB when they're here. So this partnership is something that I'm very pleased to be here speaking very positively about. Thank you very much.
That was terrific. Thank you. All right, I'll open the floor to questions in-house. The microphone is right here. Make a line. And maybe as the line is queuing, I have a question from the online audience, Dr. McDonald. And this question actually comes from Peter Jadicki. He's a teacher with a member of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, and he's organized a group viewing tonight at Fanshawe College in London. So here's the student's question. Can the new equipment that has been installed at the SNOW laboratory still monitor neutrinos coming from deep space so SNOW would know if a supernova occurred in a nearby part of the galaxy?
The answer is definitely yes. Both HALO and SNOW Plus would have that capability. Basically, I mean, he says deep space. What we're talking about is a sensitivity within our own galaxy, essentially, in terms of having significant numbers of events occurring, but we would have hundreds to thousands of events for a supernova taking place in our galaxy, where all of a sudden, instead of seeing a neutrino an hour, we would see those hundreds of events in a few seconds. And so it's quite a distinctive process. And we're part of a network called SNOOS, Supernova Early Warning System, where where you attempt not to snooze, but always be awake because these are other experiments that have the capability of observing a burst of neutrinos as well as a connection to one of the, I think it's Sky and Telescope, so that amateurs can be coupled in quickly. Because it turns out that if you do get a confirmation, particularly if two experiments see it at the same time, it's unlikely to be an instrumental effect. And you have a couple of hours in the typical development of a supernova to be ready to see the light that develops. It develops more slowly because the neutrinos happen almost instantly, but the ability for light to get out of the very dense supernova takes a while. And so we're hoping that astronomers and instruments can be aimed very limited ability to tell them the direction, but that's the idea, to be ready for that.
Great, thank you. Let's go in-house.
Thank you for the wonderful talk here. The question I have, it has a finite mass and therefore it has a percentage of the speed of light. Is there any theoretical calculations of what its velocity would be and in the different flavors, how they relate to each other for speed?
Well, the question of exactly how fast they travel is very specific to what the mass is that you find, and knowing that mass gives you, from special relativity, essentially what the velocity is that they're traveling at. And so that mass to velocity relationship is one-to-one, and so that's well defined. The question of exactly what the mass is when you measure it, what you measure is one of the neutrino types, and it will be a combination of those masses. And so in the process, the mass influences the velocity with respect to the speed of light.
Yeah, I was just kind of wondering, is there a theoretical construct of, say, 80% of the speed of light for these particles?
There is not a well-defined theoretical construct, and I'll speak again in terms of the mass, which gives you that percentage. There's not a well-defined theoretical construct yet as to exactly what the origin of the set of masses that are known, which we only know differences so far, actually should be. But the best theory, as Neil mentioned, is one that involves processes that are happening at very high energies. And a neutrino type that is different from the ones we observe at the lower energies that has a very, very high mass and influences overall in the theory how small the masses are for the ones we observe. So we don't yet know how to calculate the mass is the simple answer to what you asked.
Thank you. Aidan?
Hi there. Wow, that's high. Good.
Okay. So I know for a fact that tellurium is radioactive in all of its isotopes. So wouldn't the radioactivity mess with your other experiments?
Well, that's an extremely good question. It turns out that not all of the isotopes are radioactive, and even the one we're looking for is not very radioactive because it has this very long half-life. But you also have, with the detector, the ability to look in a certain energy range with respect to what the effect would be from this neutrinoless double beta decay. So you're looking in a very specific region, which, as it happens, none of the other isotopes interfere with when it comes to trying to measure neutrinoless double beta decay using tellurium. So they're out of the way.
Okay.
Thank you. Oh, wonderful.
Whew!
Art, I have a question, and we have to preface it. You're such a humble man. I'm not going to let you skate past this question. You said you decided to tackle a question that was outside the standard model. That took courage. Can you talk to us about how you came to the decision to tackle the question?
Well, there were 16 of us back then who realized that we could contribute either a good answer to how the sun burns or whether you needed to have changes to the standard solar model, model of elementary particles. And so if you could do it, and that was really the daunting aspect of it, building this enormous detector in an ultra-clean way underground and risking that amount of heavy water and so on was really what was daunting to us. We knew that the science was there one way or the other when we started out. I'd say it was a pretty courageous group that set out to do this in the first place. But sometimes, big payoffs require that sort of leap. So,
thank you. All right, we're going to go back online, and I have a question here. Can there be cold neutrinos? That is, neutrino-sized particles that are stationary and thus may be dark matter.
They're stationary and, say it again?
Stationary and neutrino-sized and stationary and thus may be dark matter.
And thus may be dark matter. We don't necessarily think that dark matter is stationary. We think that it's going past us with a measurable or with a significant velocity, hundreds of kilometers per second. Neutrinos do have a rest mass, a finite rest mass, and therefore they're not traveling at the speed of light. Therefore, you could conceivably stop a neutrino and have it be a finite mass particle. There's no physics that says you can't do that. How you do it is another question. Rather difficult to influence them. But fundamentally, there's no reason why they, like any other particle with a finite rest mass, could not be stopped.
Okay, thank you. Let's go in-house.
Regarding your earlier remark about detecting supernovas, is it possible to build a detector that can tell which direction the neutrino came from?
There already is, I mean, yes, but it turns out not with tremendous accuracy. The Super Cameo Candy experiment, which is the largest, their experiment is ordinary water about seven times bigger than our detector, and they have a particular reaction, which I didn't show you, it also occurs in our detector, where a neutrino comes in and scatters off an electron, and that has a directionality to it, which would enable a measurement within about, I think it's about 5 degrees on the sky. And so for that reaction, which is a small fraction actually of the total number that they would observe, other reactions would dominate it, but there would be some component of the neutrinos observed from a supernova that would have that sort of pointing accuracy. And so it depends really on how close the supernova is as to how well defined statistically that direction would be.
Thank you. Let's have the last question. You are getting over a cold from California. Can you tell us what was happening in California?
Yeah, so...
And let me step away.
It turns out... It turns out that one of our students at Princeton, when I was there, is the scientific consultant for the Big Bang Theory. And he said to me after, he sent me congratulations at the time of the prize, if you're going to be in Los Angeles on a Tuesday night, it'd be great to have you come around and be the geek of the week at the filming of the Big Bang Theory. He has been given license to bring in a scientist for the producers and writers and so on to see what a real live scientist looks like. And so my son, who was a drama major and then in film post-production, and I and his wife went and observed the filming of the Big Bang Theory last Tuesday. I was speaking at Caltech otherwise, and so it was an opportunity to do it. And I have to say, it's very impressive to see the professional approach that they take to this. They really, first of all, David Salzberg, makes sure that every blackboard you see in that show is correct, that the physics is on there in a correct way. And he also tries to inject a certain amount of topical nature to the subjects. Some of the things they're dealing with are a little bit fanciful, and as they try to move from quantum vortices to things that would be actually of practical use, for example. But One thing that he did put into the show, for example, recently is, and you may have seen the episode, is where they were trying to buy liquid helium on the black market off the back of a truck. And that's a legitimate problem. The amount of helium we have available for scientists is quite restrictive and turning out to be a problem these days. So the show is pretty good from that point of view, but the professional nature that where they go through the actual filming process and everybody knows their role in all elements of the show was really wonderful to behold. So it was fun.
Ladies and gentlemen, Nobel laureate Dr. Art McDonald.